Good now. I hope you're doing well. Preferably splentastic, especially if you are a fellow nature enthusiast, bug, insect, wildlife enthusiast, or maybe a photographer. Maybe you are just starting out, getting your feet wet, or maybe you've been photographing for many, many years. In either case, welcome to a video where I will be taking a close-up look at the various fascinating, well, at least what I find fascinating, features of about 10 or 12 insect species from close-up macro photos that I captured about 15 years ago in around 2005. This was a passion of mine for a few years. I got into photography for the first time back around in the early 2000s, 2002, something like that. I dabbled into photography as a kid in my teens with a disposable camera here and there, but I never really took it seriously. Never really knew what I wanted to do with my life throughout most of my life. And photography was just, especially when it comes to insect macro photography, this was just another creative outlet. Me trying to figure out if, this is something I wanted to do. It turned out to be a very passionate hobby. And like with some of my various hobbies, I get real obsessed and passionate about them. And then after a month or maybe after a year or two, they kind of fizzle out and I'm on to something else. So I started with a Canon 10D and a 100 millimeter macro lens after doing a lot of different research to figure out what kind of camera to start off with. And then for some of these extremely close-up photos, and these are the photos you see here are just a sample of the ones that I have. I have about 50 photos that I've kept over the years. Like I said, about 15 years ago. And like the bottom left there, the extreme close-up of that fly's head and its eyes, that was with a lens called the Canon MPE 65 millimeter lens, and it had the ability to capture 5 times the life size. So normal macro lenses, which you may or may not be familiar with, and by the way, if you're not a photographer or whatever, you're just here to relax and chill out, and that's, you're more than welcome to stay along, so the Canon MPE, about a $1,500 lens, if I'm not mistaken, a bit pricey for a hobby, is like taking a microscope into the field. And that is really, ever since I was a kid, I've been fascinated with insects and spiders, bugs of all kinds. I don't know why, but it's the details, it's their behaviors that I find absolutely just fascinating. And this isn't so much about, look at the photos I've taken, but I want to just look at the details and share them with you, because these are some things that, we don't often get to see. We just don't really see the small world around us up close that very often, not on TV, not on Netflix. I mean, I don't know when the last time I saw a bug or insect documentary. Why don't we get started, and I'll talk a little bit about the some of the knowledge that I picked up myself as I became more and more knowledgeable and aware of what I was photographing. And that's one thing with photographing or just being out in nature. When you stop to take a look around and even get down close to the ground and you start to really take a look at what's unfolding around you, the ants and things like that, you start to see a world that you just don't often see. And that's really, you know, what's fascinating and what's opened up my eyes. So we'll take a look, we'll go through like alphabetically through different species that I was able, very fortunate enough, to capture and observe in their natural environment. None of these were captured and brought home and put in the freezer to temporarily slow down their systems so I could place them and then take photos. The challenge for me was always photographing the insects in their natural environment. And one last thing, and we'll get into the photos here in just a moment. I would spend about 3 hours on a Saturday or a Sunday, and I would come away with maybe 5, maybe 10, but I don't really know. It was a small number of actual good photos worth keeping, because I would photograph handheld, rarely with a tripod, because insects are always moving. And so handheld, when you're photographing small things with a handheld camera, they get blurry and things like that. So there was a lot of out of focus issues, especially with the really close up stuff. So I would spend 3 hours. I would go out in the woods, or I would go to a pond that's like 2 hours, not 2 hours away, maybe an hour and a half away. I had to drive to another state that had a pond that I could get access to that had dragonflies and all kinds of insect life going on. It wasn't every weekend. It was about, I'd say, once or twice a month, not every month, springtime, sometimes in the summer, sometimes in the fall. So it was a very short window of opportunity to go out and photograph certain insects, because they're only, some are only busy at certain times of the year and things like that. And you just don't walk out into the woods or into a field and expect to find insects. You have to like hunt them down, because they're not always just, you know, easily seen. Okay, so let's take a look at the some of the ant photos that I captured. And just real quick, I'll just go through the ones that I have, that I've kept. There are about six of them or so. And I'll just kind of go over what we see, because, again, it's not so much the photos themselves. It's the details. This is what really fascinates me. So here is a picture of, I'm not exactly sure of the particular ant species, but you can see it's carrying an egg, an ant egg with, that might be a little baby ant in there. I'm not sure of the exact scientific term, pupa, maybe. I don't really know if this was a 100mm macro lens or the MPE, the really extreme close-up macro lens. But yeah, so this was just, I happened to be out and noticed some ants on the ground carrying their eggs from one nest to another, I suppose, and I just, you know, that was one of them. This is another type of ant species, and again, one of the other aspects of this was that I was learning about new species. When you think about ants, you might think about the real small ones that you'll see around, candy or food, right? The real tiny ones, or the big black ants, the carpenter ants. Well, this is I don't think it's the ones that you see around candy or gum you know, falling on the curb, on the sidewalk. Those are called false honey ants. Well, I mean, there's a lot of variety of ants, but here in the United States, the really tiny brown ones are, I'll show you here. This is a false honey ant, what I was trying to explain. So it's a little bit different than this one. I think this is a Cremogaster, if I'm not mistaken. I was, about 15 years ago, like I said, I was really, I had a lot of, I don't remember much now, but I was learning a lot about the different species. And you can see just some of the details here, like on the thorax, little spikes here, and kind of separates it from the different species, I believe. And what this particular ant is doing is waiting for this other bug, and I forget the name of it offhand as well. This is a scale insect, and it feeds off of this is a tree. It's a small tree, and this is just one of the branches on the tree, and there's these white scale insects which feed on the tree's sap, and they excrete a sugary substance. I forget the actual name of it. And so they feed on the tree sap, and whatever they, I guess, don't need from the sap, they excrete. And like I said, it's somewhat of a sugary substance. But in either case, it's a clear, it's called like honeydew, is another name for it. And so the ants will wait for the scale insects to secrete that, and they will drink it up, and it'll become a source of food or whatever for this particular species. All right, so these are the false honey ants, very common here in the United States. These love all types of food and sugar. So if you have, you know, a piece of gum on the sidewalk or in the street, or, you know, food laying around in your house, you're sure to attract these type of ants. And this was a very close-up photo, and this is exactly what I love about the particular the lens. I think I was using the Canon MPE with this, but you can see all the facets of the ant's eyes, all the hairs, the mandibles, the I guess you would call the teeth of the mandibles, its mouth right there. Just absolutely, that's, you know, what I love. I really didn't go out to photograph insects to take good photos. It was more of an opportunity for me to come back and just, wow, look at that. Look at the details. And is what fascinated me. Here is another picture of a false honey ant. And you can see it has just some dirt that it is, I guess, excavating from that ant, their little ant, what am I trying to say, their nest in the ground. So when you see ants, you know, carrying out little piles of dirt from the little ant hole, this is a close-up look at exactly that. And this is a very interesting behavior that I didn't even know about until I was able to capture it. This is called trophallaxis, if I'm not mistaken. And it looks like they're kissing. They are actually sharing fluids from their stomachs. I'm not sure if they have more than one stomach, ants, but in any case, you will see some ants, their abdomens get very large from storing a lot of liquid, honeydew or water, whatever it is. And this behavior is where they actually exchange the stored liquids with their fellow ants to either, I guess, give them a drink, or maybe for that ant to take it back to the nest. So I was able to, I saw that behavior, and I was like, you know, what are those two ants doing? I got very lucky. I was able to capture, you can see their ant tongues, a little blurry, but yeah, I'm not sure who's feeding who, but that's just a pretty cool behavior I never knew that ants did engage it in. And again, two ants. These might be honey ants. They look like a different species from that ant we saw earlier with the spikes in its thorax. But again, they are waiting for the scale insect to secrete some honeydew. All right, so the next species we are taking a look at are assassin bugs, and I never knew these really existed. They are simply fascinating. And again, I'm just an amateur insect photographer hobbyist when I was doing this. So this is an assassin bug nymph. It's not an adult. And you can see here in these three photos, let's see if I get a closer up look. It's basically, obviously, trying to make a meal out of this little leaf hopper. And leaf hoppers feed on plants, and certain insects feed on leaf hoppers. Everything feeds on each other in the world. But so you can see a nymph here. An assassin bug, very cool, very slow. They can fly around short distances, and they just, like their name states, they slowly creep up, slow as they can, to capture their prey. Just like you see here, this is an adult assassin bug, and it is feeding on a bumblebee, or a carpenter bee. Kind of hard to tell between the two. And so they use their beak to pierce their prey in like a spider. They inject it with, I don't know, some kind of, I guess, a poison or something that probably causes the internal organs to liquefy, and then they just suck them out with their mouth, proboscis, that's like a straw, like a fly has. Like a spider does with its prey. It uses its fangs. Well, assassin bug uses its long, sharp beak to do just that. And this was just I just walked around some different areas, an arboretum, a park, but anything that has fields and different types of trees, you're not really going to find a whole lot of insect varieties in the forest, in the woods, besides like spiders, certain things on occasion, flies, but I find in the areas where there are lots of flowering plants, you're going to find a lot of more insect varieties than you would in just in the woods that just has, you know, conifers and trees and not too many flowers and such. And this is a very extreme close-up of, it might be the same assassin bug. You can see its eye right there. I'm not sure if this red dot on top of its head is another eye. It could be its antenna. And of course, a close-up look at its drinking straw, its mouth parts that it uses to, like I said, to get the nutrients it needs from its prey. And here is, I'm not sure if this is the same one or not, but another close-up look. Probably a different one. I might have scared it and it went underneath. I can't recall. Another close-up look from a different angle. You can see some other flies are also making somewhat of a meal on this dead bumblebee. And here is one of the most unique situations that I've ever stumbled upon is an assassin bug feeding on a caterpillar. And I forget exactly, I did remember at one point, I tried to identify what particular caterpillar species this was. But I was just walking around and came upon this particular tree in a certain arboretum. I'm not sure what type of tree it is. You can see the tree's fruit right there. But I just happened to, you know, notice this long shape hanging from the tree. And upon closer inspection, I found out it was, you know, what you see here, an assassin bug that captured a caterpillar. So it has quite a big meal here, that's for sure. And I have a very close-up look of the caterpillar. You can see over here the caterpillars, the pads of its feet, the little hairs. I think these are the little holes where the caterpillar takes in oxygen, if I'm not mistaken, or might not be. There is a certain name for the openings on certain insects when they take in the, you know, for how they breathe. Okay, but yeah, this is just another close-up of that caterpillar. And down here at the bottom, you can see, I think this is probably where it may be the assassin bug. If you take a look down here, there is some secretion of some kind of fluid from the caterpillar coming out. It could be because maybe that's where the assassin bug initially pierced it, or, you know, who knows what. So that is that. And I just, like, again, I just find the details simply fascinating. You know, all the hairs of the assassin bug. Another close-up look of the caterpillar's hind feet, I guess you would say, because its head is down towards the bottom. And then again, another look at the assassin bug. There's its sharp beak, and that's its mouth. Its mouth is a stabbing, piercing weapon. And again, that is a young nymph. Unable, hasn't developed its wings yet or anything. And here is another different nymph feeding on a beetle. I'm not sure what beetle species it is, but yeah. And that is it for the assassin bugs. Next up, we have several species of different bees and wasps. I know we're going alphabetically here, but I kind of threw bees and wasps together under B for bees, so you'll have to forgive me. This is I used to know, 15 years ago, what all these different species were, their names, but, well, what they say, if you don't use it, you lose it, as the saying goes. But this, some of these wasp species are designed to feed on caterpillars and maybe some other bugs. But I know certain species like this, they fly around. You see them around rocks and bushes, and you're not sure what they're doing. They're not feeding on nectar. Well, they're actually hunting for caterpillars, if not any other species. And I guess they hunt by the scent of the caterpillar, or the pheromones, or whatever. So that is that particular wasp species. This here is a type of bee. It might be a wasp. Not actually sure. I forget exactly. It's not a honeybee. I don't think it's a fly. There are some flies that look like bees. But yeah, just another really close up look, overhead look of a bee as it's trying to gather some nectar from this particular plant. Here is another type of bee. Again, it might be a wasp. I'm just going to say bee. Here you can see its mouth parts, its tongue, and it has little additional parts at the tip of its tongue as it, I guess it's like a straw, and I'm assuming it's trying to gather the nectar. I don't think bees feed on pollen. So I think it's, yeah, the nectar. And again, just a very close up. This is just what I love, is seeing all the details. And I just never really seen stuff like this until I began to take these photos. And here you can even see, like, the little bee feet, little claws, whatever the proper word is for the end of the little bee's feet. And this one, you can see, has a kind of an amber thorax or abdomen. I guess the thorax is, right, the top part, and the abdomen is the butt. All right. Next, we have just another type of bee. This was just more of a kind of going for kind of a, you know, an artistic kind of look here. But again, look at the all covered, completely covered in pollen. Again, just another close-up look of a bee, just trying to capture some of the behaviors, and it's loaded up with pollen. And here is an extreme close-up. I think this probably was taken with the Canon MPE. Here you can see a honeybee as it has its tongue extended, and you can see by the movement, the blurred movement of its wings, it's either in the process of hovering or landing or whatever. You can see some of the pollen that it has gathered in the little sacs around its legs. I forget the actual name. I used to know that too. But yeah, this is what really is what, like I said, and I'm repeating myself, but yeah, you know, just seeing the tongue and being able to capture that is what I was, is what I really loved to see. So I just got really lucky that day. I was able to, you know, it's not easy when you have to deal with holding a camera, trying to take a really close up photo without a tripod, and while the bee is actively buzzing around, you can take 50 photos and you might, you know, come up with just one good photo that's in focus. And here are two bees. I'm not sure what type of bee. They might be mining bees or carpenter bees. But obviously they were mating. I'm assuming one is a female. Maybe the male's on top here and the female's on the bottom. But I can only assume that they were in the process of mating or about to. I just happened to walking around and noticed them on the ground. And I was like, okay, I'll take a photo. I'm sure they didn't appreciate me taking a photo of them during this intimate moment. I apologize for disrespecting their privacy. They probably don't even want this on the internet. They'll probably end up suing me, or their family, at least. So, yeah, but I can only assume that's the behavior, but just really cool to see the different colors of these that particular bee species, especially the one that is more white. Usually the bumblebees or carpenter bees are often brownish in tone in their colors. So these are mining bees, and maybe that's what these are. But I don't think so. These particular bees will dig burrows in the ground in soft soil. They'll go down, and then they'll have additional horizontal tunnels where they lay their eggs for their young. And they will, like most bees, go out and gather nectar. And I just happened to walk around wherever I was, and I saw all these holes on the dirt path. And I was wondering, you know, whenever I see them, I'm always curious. You know, whenever I see something out of the ordinary, I'm kind of always curious to begin with. And I was like, you know, what's in all these different holes? And I just happened to notice some, you know, bees, you know, buzzing around, and they would go in and come out of the holes. And I just happened to get lucky about this cute little mining bee. There's a couple different species, if I'm not mistaken. I think one of them is mining bee. There's another word for them as well. But yeah, they make their nest in the dirt. Kind of, you know, that's where they, you know, keep, raise their young. Kind of like what the hornet, the cicada killer hornet does. It hunts down cicadas, drags them, you know, paralyzes them, drags them underground, And then I think lays one egg on them, and its young cicada killer wasp will make a meal out of the cicada. Here's just another angle of the mining bee coming out of its little burrow. Nothing too fancy there. Another angle, another look. Get a chance to see the, you know, the stripes on its abdomen there, some of the details in the wings. And this is either a bumblebee or a carpenter bee. I was trying to get a few photos. I think I have two of them. We'll get to that one in a second. I was trying to capture, make some artistic compositions of bees in flight. So I got lucky that I was able to capture a few that came out all right, that were in focus. And this is just another a bumblebee or a carpenter bee getting ready to approach, make its landing on these pink flowers. Same here, just a reverse view of the bumblebee butt. And then here is an extreme close-up with that really extreme macro lens, underside view of the bumblebee or carpenter bee's tongue. You can see there some little, whatever these might be, at the tip of the tongue, not sure. I'm assuming it's going after the nectar in this flower. And you can see the bumblebee's mandibles or jaws, some hairs in there. I'm assuming the hairs help clean the tongue. That's my assumption. And we even get a chance to see some of the close-up of the flower's pistils or stamens. I'm not a flower expert, so. And then the last photo is a paper wasp. They are called paper wasps because they make their nests out of a paper-like material. They chew up wood, bits of wood and grass, straw, or whatever, into a substance, and they actually make their little nest out of, you know, the chewed up bits of natural wood fibers that they find. And this one just happened to be, paper wasp's nest was hanging from the underside of some kind of plant or reed. There was one particular pond I would travel to once a year, maybe twice. It was quite a distance away. There's not too many ponds here in the southeast Pennsylvania area, or in the mid-Atlantic region. Mostly so much land is developed. There's a lot of lakes, but just not too many ponds. Or too many ponds that you can access. You know, there are probably some that are on private property or whatnot. But yeah, you can see close-up look of the paper wasp's eye right there, and its mandibles, and just, like I said, I love the details. So, and that's going to do it for the bees and wasps. Next, we have butterflies. And again, I used to know the different species. I forget most of them now. Here is a small species of butterfly. I'm not really sure what that is on its tongue. I'm assuming that could be a parasite or an egg of some kind, or maybe a piece of pollen. I don't really know, but you can see it's proboscis there. Its mouth is a straw, obviously, and it's getting as much nectar as it can from this particular flowering plant. Here we have two monarch butterflies getting nectar from one particular plant species, and I have no idea. I have no knowledge about plants. Again, another close-up look, monarch butterfly. Just getting nectar from this particular species of plant. I just love, I love butterflies, but you know, the monarchs and whatever else there might be, just so striking with their colors. Just another photo of monarchs feeding on a plant. Here is a real close-up. See if I can get this moved over there, of another monarch butterfly. Looks like a little bit of nectar there on its straw mouth, on its proboscis, wherever you say that word. And yeah, just another close-up look at all the details, all the little hairs on its body. Kind of out of focus there with the eyes, but a very limited or very shallow depth of field. That's the one thing with macro. I'm not sure if you're aware, but when you're taking close-up photos of small things, you don't get everything in focus. It's very difficult to get things in focus when you're doing it, when you're using a camera that's handheld, because then you start to have issues with blur, movement blur, and things like that. And here is a another species of butterfly, and I believe this is called a spice bush swallowtail. There are, I think, two species of swallowtails, two or three, that look like this. That might be a spice bush swallowtail, might be another species, but I'm going to go with the spice bush. Again, very just, you know, really interesting colors. You can see its tail colors there. Just a very, another cool species of butterfly. Again, another angle, same type of species, I believe. You get to see the underside color of its wings as it's feeding on whatever species of flowers those are. And here is a another species of butterfly that I used to know what the name was, but you can see mostly orange in color, orange body, eyes, everything is orange. Very cool, very pretty butterfly. Another beautiful species of insect. You can see its antenna right there, its proboscis, its legs, its abdomen, of course, and the unique color and pattern of its wings. And there is an extreme close-up of the same species. Here we have the eyes, its head, its legs over here, and a close-up. Very lucky to get this, capture this moment, because it moves its proboscis around quite quickly, and they're always moving as well. So I was just very fortunate to capture that close-up shot there. Here is another type of butterfly. I believe, I don't think it's a moth, just because of the fact of the arrangement of its wings. I don't think most moths don't have wings like this. But I could be mistaken. It could be a moth. But I'm pretty sure it's a butterfly. When I was doing my research back then, around this time, I'm pretty sure I learned that it was a butterfly. But yeah, very cool. A lot of, it's very small compared to the monarch. And that's it for the butterflies. Next we have dragonflies and damselflies. And again, I love these. They're just so very unique. You don't often get a chance to see them, you know, every day, compared to flies and bees and ants. So these were captured, most of these photos were captured near a particular pond that I had to drive like an hour and a half to get to. And this particular dragonfly, whose name a darner. I think it's a darner. That's the name of the species. And just basking in the sun, and you can see its eyes are looking right at me, wondering if I'm going to make a meal out of it, but all I ever did was observe and take photos of the insects in their natural environments and just left them alone. That's all I was like a scientist, I guess you would say, but I didn't meddle. But yeah, so it was just on the ground and I just snapped that photo of it. Here is a damselfly, and the difference between a damselfly and a dragonfly is the dragonfly's wings are usually stretched out or arranged horizontally, or perpendicular to its body, whereas a damselfly, when it rests its wings, it will be in the same direction as its body. So that's like the first major difference between damselflies and dragonflies. And there's some other differences in their attributes, such as their, you know, damselflies extended, you know, long thorax here. And so this one was just resting on a leaf. Here is a close-up of probably the same damselfly. I think it's actually smiling. See its mandibles, its eyes, some of the facets in the eyes there. You can make that out a little bit. And their bodies are quite, what's the word? Reflective. There's another word. Not luminescent. Phosphorescent? No, there's another word. But yeah. Here is another dragonfly. This may either be a female or a juvenile of a particular species because of its coloring. I'm not really sure, but just resting on a particular plant stem. Might be a stem of a reed. This was near the pond I was talking about. Here is a blue, I forget the name, another dragonfly. I used to, again, I don't remember the names of the species so much anymore, but it's a blue something, I'm pretty sure, is in the name. Just resting on a pond, a lily pad on the surface of the pond. I'm pretty sure. I'm not, or maybe another large plant. I'm not sure. Yeah, I can't recall. Actually, it doesn't really matter too much. I wasn't able to get into the pond. So, I don't know, maybe it was. Same type of species, again, resting on a pond reed. And just notice the blue, and its thorax is fairly long, like a damselfly, but not quite as thin and not quite as long. And again, you can see the wings, they go horizontal, you know, compared to the damselfly, you know, when they're resting. You can see the inside of the damselfly's head and its eyes. It's almost hollow right there, which is pretty interesting. It has these giant eyes, which are pretty much its head, and then kind of concave or convex right in there. It looks like almost as if there is no, you know, there's no brain or anything. It's very interesting. But I think that allows them to move their eyes or their head all around different directions. Another different kind of species. You can see it's partly blue. Eyes are somewhat green, and the body is a little bit yellow. I don't know the name of the species offhand. But yeah, it's resting on a pond reed near the pond. You can see all the lily pads. Close up of the same species. You can see it's. I use the flash. So not a lot of natural light. I don't know if I blinded the poor dragonfly. Yeah, you can see a really close-up look at the details of its mouth that uses to eat whatever insects it catches. And its little antenna. And whatever else is going on up here. sensory organs, maybe, the facets of its eyes, and the dark pupil. It almost looks like it has a lot of different pupils, but I'm an expert. And here is a calico pennant is the name of this particular dragonfly. And I have that ingrained into my memory because this is a very rare species that I was ever saw when I would make my trips to this pond. And so I was very, very fortunate to get this kind of a clean photo of it while it was resting on a twig there in the sun by the pond. I just got lucky that it didn't fly away when I got this close to it. But you can see the details. I love it. I love the details in the wings, the structure there. Somewhat each one almost very symmetrical in design. I mean, just look at that when you try to compare, the two sides. They're almost very, it's just amazing. Nature is pretty dang cool. Another angle of this same dragonfly. And again, you can see, I was talking about earlier, how in the back of its eyes, it's like hollow. And it's just, I find that very, very odd. But yet interesting at the same time. So its head is like just a giant pair of eyes, pretty much. Another close-up look there. See all the hairs. Another close-up look of the thorax, some of the wings. Another close-up look. Even better look at the head right there. Look at that. Isn't that amazing? And this is the stuff that I really was most important to me when capturing these photos, was knowing that I'd come back home, open them up on the computer, and get to see these kind of details that you would just never get to see, by simple observations. And so that's really, what I love the most. Just look at that wing, all the cells, so-called cells of the, I'm not sure the exact term, but, it's like stained glass window. It's amazing. Okay. And here's that, another green darner, I think, resting on a plant, just basking in the sunlight. And here is an extreme close-up look at it. There you can see its head, facets of its eyes, staring right at me, staring right at us. Its mandibles, its organs up here for sensing, all the hairs. I just love it. If you like details like me, then yeah. So, and that's it for the dragonflies and damselflies. So we are now going to take a look at the different fly species. And, I'm sure you're familiar with the common household fly. But when you start to slow down and take a look at all the different insects around, you see there's more than just the average household fly. And this is a robber fly. These are predatory flies. They will fly around, obviously, and try to attack or capture other prey, usually other smaller flying insects like gnats. And you can see it's proboscis here, so they don't feed on like the common household fly will feed on decaying matter. These will hunt live prey, and they will stab the prey with their proboscis and do the same thing like a spider and assassin bug does. And I have found these to be simply amazing and remarkable. Here is a type of fly that I cannot remember the name of the species. Quite large, And you can see it's proboscis and it's actually feeding on the nectar of a flower. And some of these flies will actually mimic other species, such as bees. I think it's a fly, though, just because of its characteristics. But this was another behavior that that's, again, what I was really trying to go for with most of these photos, was the behavior, the details, getting to capture the proboscis, you know, gathering up the flower's nectar. Just, you know, very cool. Interesting little, don't remember the name of that species. Here is an extreme close-up look of the fly's proboscis. You can see the grains of pollen on its proboscis, the end here, details of the pads of the proboscis, and of course even its little fly foot and the pads of its foot that it uses to stick in all the hairs on the proboscis at the tip there. So that was another lucky moment that I was fortunate to capture. Next, we have a hoverfly. You might mistake this for a bee if you didn't know otherwise. I know I used to. And they get their name because they hover around. You'll see them hovering in the air around plants, or sometimes just in the air in general. I think they probably evolved to look like bees to avoid being preyed upon, predation. They are flies, most notably because of the antenna, the parts of the head here that I'm pointing to. So this one was at rest, and it may even have actually secreted little drop of, honeydew, or whatever flies, hoverflies secrete. Another hoverfly, again, resting on a particular plant leaf. Another close-up look, different angle, and then the extreme with the Canon MPE. And again, this is what fascinates me, is being able to see all the facets. Look at that. Millions. I mean, at least thousands. Tens of thousands. I don't know about millions, but look at all the facets of this fly's eyes. It's just amazing. And then, I guess, like the nose, the sensory organs. Little small antenna there. I guess it doesn't need very large antenna. And then where the wings attach, the thorax, and whatever this part might be sticking out, I don't know. But that is the hoverfly. And here are two hoverflies mating. Again, I probably should have asked their permission before taking this photo. But yeah, so male and female there. And here is another extreme close-up of a hoverfly gathering nectar. And you can see it's proboscis. It's covered in little pollen. I mean, I'm assuming that's pollen. All those little tiny little beads. You can see some sticky strands, kind of hard to make out. I'm assuming that's like the sticky strands of the nectar. But again, I was very lucky to capture this moment. Just love the details. Love being, you know, I've never seen that before. A fly's proboscis as it was trying to gather nectar. I got real lucky. Here is a robber fly feeding on a hoverfly that we just saw. So again, I never knew, you know, before this, I never knew, I'm pretty sure, that robber flies existed and that they preyed on other flies. So, you know, we always think about spiders, praying mantis. Well, how about predatory flies? So there you have it. And it, you know, sucking out, you can see that how deflated and how almost flat the hoverfly's body is, its abdomen, because the robber fly sucked out most of its internal organs, just like a spider would or an assassin bug. Here are two robber flies mating, and I'm not sure which is the male or the female, but you can see the one is clasped around the other, and in the process of going through that behavior. And I think these parts are, I forget the exact term, two mating robber flies. Here is another example of a robber fly feeding on a gnat, smaller fly. They just catch them right out of the air, usually that's how it happens, I believe. You can see it's proboscis there, pierced the smaller fly as it feeds on it. And here is another robber fly, kind of like the one we just saw, just resting on a branch. You can see it's proboscis there. A hunter of flies, who'd have thunk it? Here is another extreme close-up of the proboscis and all the hairs. Here is another type of fly. I think it's a predatory fly. I don't know if it's a robber fly, but you can see it's proboscis there. I don't know the name of the species. I'm assuming it's a predatory fly, but I might be mistaken. But just another close-up look at another type of fly species. Same species again. Possibly could be a female because of how large its abdomen is. It could have eggs, and it might be a female because it looks like this, what you might think is a tail, might be the ovipositor, how they deposit the eggs. So this could be a female. And then just another extreme close-up look at the fly's head, all the facets of the eyes there. And these little bits of yellow, I'm not sure if that fly organs or parasites, maybe. Hard to tell. And that's it for the flies. Next we have grasshoppers and katydids. So here is a typical field grasshopper. So many different species of grasshoppers and crickets. This one just happened to be basking in the sun early in the morning. When they're not quite as active, I would try to make sure when I would go to photograph all the different insects, that I got there right around dawn. Not just because when the sun gets high in the sky, it creates a lot of contrast, and can be difficult to deal with when you're trying to photograph anything. So the morning when the sun's low is usually the best time to go. So I just got real lucky with this fella. This was in the parking lot of a particular area, and it has a bunch of a nature preserve. And there was just a bunch of tall blades of grass, and it just happened to be resting right on it before it probably got a chance to warm up. So there's a real, see the details there. It's a mouth. Here is another grasshopper of sorts. I don't really know all the different species of grasshoppers, and it looks like it's probably making a wish. Here is another grasshopper. This is a young grasshopper, probably very similar to the first grasshopper. We saw it was all green. You can see its wings are not fully developed, so it's most likely a young one, just resting on a blade of grass. Very difficult to photograph grasshoppers because they will jump away just as you walk around. They're real sensitive to vibrations and sound. So here is a real close-up look of the head. And you can see all the ridges or segments of the antenna, the facets of the eyes. There's like the dark pupil. Same grasshopper, just a different view. Another grasshopper, not sure what kind. Might be a young one. I'm not really sure. Just resting there on a little leaf, unsure if it should hop away from me or not. Another close-up look, probably the same grasshopper. Again, we can see all the facets of the eyes. Even the coloring of the eyes is just pretty cool, and all the segments of the antenna. Same grasshopper again, or another one. Again, same species. Same species again, and again. And this is a katydid, and I have no idea what it's doing. I think it's eating something. I'm not sure what that dark, gooey mass is. But the difference between a katydid and a grasshopper is usually the katydids are quite larger. But most notably, the legs. If you look at a grasshopper, see how its legs are more closer to its body, like that. Katydid usually has these larger legs. And another distinct difference between grasshoppers and katydids are, I'm not sure if grasshoppers, I'm not exactly sure what sound grasshoppers make, but katydids, they make that that kind of sound with their wings or their legs, probably their wings. Usually you hear them on the summer evenings. So that's the katydid you're hearing. So this is just a close-up view. I was trying to capture whatever behavior it's doing there with that gooey black mass. I have no idea. But you can see its front little legs there. One, two, three pairs of legs. So that's something else I didn't know. Little mandible. Right. Here is another katydid. I think it's waving to us, saying hello, how are you? Or maybe it's giving me the finger. Hard to tell. Why are you bothering me? I'm just resting on this leaf. And I think this is a young katydid because of the short wings haven't fully developed. Another katydid in the process of preening one of its antenna, cleaning its antenna, and it's young. You see the wings haven't fully developed yet. Here is another katydid. This is a nymph, a very, very young. I just happened upon this buttercup flower. These are very small to begin with, so you can just imagine how much smaller this little katydid nymph is, recently hatched, no doubt, from that particular spring, most likely. Here is another large, probably a female katydid. I believe this at the bottom here is its ovipositor, where the female would lay eggs, probably into the ground. So I'm assuming that's a female. And that's it for the grasshoppers and katydids. Next, we have my favorite species of insect, the praying mantis. I absolutely love the praying mantis. I just happened to capture this at that one pond I would visit early in the morning. Some dew, morning dew on the grass. And it was just, you know, I just got lucky to see this young praying mantis. It's not quite a full adult, resting here among the grass. I absolutely love the praying mantis because I don't know what it is about them. They're so different. They seem intelligent, almost humanoid, I guess because of the eyes. But yeah, I've been They've been my favorite insect. I'm not sure about you. If you have any favorite insects, love to hear from you. And you can see this one is just preening, cleaning its legs, one of its legs. Right there. And, I'm not sure why this is in my praying mantis folder. This is a young nymph of some type of plant bug. I don't think it's an assassin bug. Could be. See, it has some spikes there to, I guess, ward off predators. Red eye. So, yeah. Not really exactly sure what species that is or why it's in my praying mantis. Here is a praying mantis egg case. I forget the name offhand. I should know this. Egg case is good enough. And they will make their little egg cases usually within, you know, shrubs, bushes, so as they're not out in the open. And I just happened to stumble upon this one. I'm not sure if the egg's hatched or not. And here is a different view of the same egg case. I was never able to catch, you know, when they're hatching. You know, I've thought about buying some, a praying mantis, or an egg case and film it as they hatch, in an aquarium or something like that. Just another praying mantis on this plant that's somewhat dying. This might be in the fall. Just patiently waiting for anything to show up. I'm not sure if it was ever lucky. I would sit and observe the insects to see if I could catch them in any particular, natural behavior. But, it's very rare or difficult to wait and to time, some bug coming that would then I'll be able to capture the praying mantis, actually going after the bug. I mean, I could have brought with me some sugar water, things like that to attract, but I never did that. I always just captured things in the environment as they were without meddling. Just another picture of a young praying mantis. I don't think it's an adult yet. Among the reeds of a pond, upside down like that. Another praying mantis, just kind of surprised to see me, probably wondering if I'm going to eat it, but of course I didn't. Another praying mantis among the reeds, kind of reaching out a little bit towards the camera. Nice underside look of it. Here is a praying mantis eating some type of caterpillar or grub of some kind. I'm not sure what all this mess is. It looks like maybe the grub's internal organs have been distended out of its body by being squeezed by the praying mantis, but you can see the praying mantis has one eye on me as I take a photo of it eating. And this is the type of behaviors I loved to capture. You just never see this on TV or anything. I wish we would. I love this stuff. Just another praying mantis posing for me on the pond reed. And that's it for the mantises. Next, I have just two images of what's called a hummingbird moth. They behave quite like hummingbirds in the way they hover around and fly. But they are actually moths, as you can see. You typical moth type of look to it. There's a proboscis, and that's just, I was very lucky fortunate to capture them during this behavior. I was walking around a particular arboretum and happened to notice these particular insects kind of hovering, flying around, and I'm not sure if I ever knew what they were, but I was very fortunate to capture them in mid-flight somewhat, because they don't really land They kind of like hover around and drink and then move on. So, not very often seen, that's for sure. And the last, but by no means the very least, are spiders. Not an insect, but a bug nonetheless. They are arachnids in their own little genre, family. And so there are crab spiders, jumping spiders. This is a jumping spider, a back view of one of them as it's on a branch. I absolutely love spiders. I have a love-hate relationship with them. I absolutely love just everything about them. You know, the webs, you know, just their behaviors, you know, what they are and all that. But as I began to photograph more of these other spiders called jumping spiders, which you see here, I began to find out there's quite a lot of variety of species. And I began to love the jumping spiders. They are cute and adorable. There's just something about them. They seem a little bit more intelligent than their other eight-legged counterparts that sit in webs. There's just something about jumping spiders. Here is one jumping spider. It could be a female feeding on a hoverfly or a flower fly. And they don't, jumping spiders, of course they jump to get from one location to another, but they don't build webs. They're like wolf spiders. They roam around. I'm not sure where they lay their eggs, if they have a web or anything like that, a nest, but here is another black jumping spider. These are often very aggressive. You might have seen this type around your, you know, outside your house in the bushes. These black jumping spiders seem to be quite the aggressive bunch compared to most others. But this one just happened to be resting on the underside of a pond reed. There's another little brown jumping spider. Quite curious. They'll jump on you, walk around you. They are very docile compared to most other spiders. They seem quite curious. Here is another jumping spider just resting on a piece of bark. You can see how it almost blends in with the foliage around it. All the little hairs, the eyes. Another jumping spider surveying where it will jump to next. And these are all different species, by the way. There's another one. You can see part of its mandible right there. So it's probably preening or cleaning its mouth parts on this particular leaf. Another jumping spider. You can see the fluorescent nature of its mouth parts, its mandibles right inside there. Some jumping spiders are very colorful. So again, just kind of looking up towards the camera there. Another overhead view of a jumping spider. Very colorful. Some orange pattern there. Another jumping spider. Just looking around. Same one. Here is an orb weaver spider. I should know the name of it. This is a very unique species. Man, I used to have this name of this particular species of orb weaver ingrained. But you'll find these throughout the world. They have a very distinct yellow abdomen and white head or thorax. And this one captured a dragonfly, an adult, full-sized dragonfly. This was one of the largest I've seen of this particular species. Its web was about, I don't know, it had to be like 1 foot in width, and it was between pond reeds. So it had a great web built right near the pond, And it was large, this spider. It had to be, its body had to be like 4 or 5 inches, no lie. It was one of the biggest I've seen of this particular species. And you can see by the size of the dragonfly that it caught in the web. So, but yeah, these are orb weavers. They make their webs in a very circular pattern. Here is a crab spider, and it's doing what crab spiders do, sitting in wait by a flower, or actually inside the flower, waiting for some kind of flying insect to arrive, and it just remains perfectly still. It has one leg, there's probably a strand of web right there, perhaps, so it can make a quick escape. That's my only thought about why that leg is like that. And they just sit and wait with their legs like that, ready to grasp and ensnare whatever bee or fly might happen to show up. There is a front view. See, just waiting and patiently waiting. Here is an extreme close-up using that Canon MPE lens. You can see just amazing the characteristics of the head of this particular crab spider, the eyes in front, on top, all the little hairs, and even its little mandibles right there. I just got real lucky when photographing that. Here is another crab spider. Do I have two of these? Yeah, here's a little bit more of a distant look of this particular species. You might not even notice this crab spider here among this particular plant. It's very well camouflaged. I didn't notice it at first. And just look at its legs. Look at this particular plant. This is one thing that fascinates me with nature, and especially camouflage. And just look how this spider, over the millions of years, has adapted to, you know, pretty much blend into its environment. And you can see the pistils or the stamens of the flower resemble the legs of this particular crab spider. And it's, again, just waiting for something to show up, a bee, so that it can, you know, grab it. And you wouldn't never notice that, you know? So it's just fascinating. And this is just a closer look at it. Another look from a different angle. You can see, just totally blends in. Another orb weaver, very small. You can see the reflective little patch of color there on its abdomen. Just waiting in its web, in the center of its web, for anything to land for its next meal. And this is the last spider photo that I have, or that I kept. I weeded out a lot of duplicates, and, you know, try to just keep the best of the best of the best of the best. This is a close-up look of a crab spider. It was crawling along this leaf, and then it extended its arms as I got close, I guess, ready for self-defense or maybe make a meal out of me. But there's a close-up look at it. You can see right there where it bends its legs, all its eyes, and its mandibles. And that's going to do it. So, from me and all of my insect friends, thank you very much for watching, for tuning in. I hope you maybe found this somewhat, you know, educational, informative, enjoyable to watch, hopefully relaxing as well. And if you are someone that enjoys photographing, or maybe you're thinking about getting into it, or you're, you know, just starting out, I wish you all my best. Best of luck in capturing and taking photos of whatever it is, insects, birds, or, you know, maybe you photograph, you know, people or whatever it might be. So best of luck to you, And hopefully I'll see you around again sometime, maybe in the next video. And until then, stay safe, take care of yourself, and just, you know, try to stop sometimes and take a close look around at the, you know, the plants and the grass and the dirt around you, or the trees and the branches, because you'll never know what you might see up close when you stop to, you know, take a moment to look and let things just happen without rushing past them all the time. So long, and take care for now.